Let's go ahead and bring in Ivan Vyazmitinov, who
Hello,
is technical lead in accidental DBA. How you doing?
Perfectly fine, thanks.
Awesome. He also is a Citus open source user and is going to be talking today about JSON and analytics and putting all that together. So let's turn it over to Ivan and we'll get started.
Yes. Hello, everyone. This talk will show you a successful example of real-time analytics based on semi-structured data, JSON, and how Citus helps with shortcomings of that. It will be especially useful for those who consider JSONB for such workload, to know caveats, tips, and tricks, and again, how Citus helps you with distribution capabilities. Now, here is my short info and my socials. We are a company that makes social and mobile games. You might have heard about Klondike Adventures, that's us. There is also a short list of our achievements. And we are also big believers in open source and encourage every user of open source to join the contributing community. Now, with that out of the way, let's get started. So, first, I'd like to discuss the division of labor in our company. Here we have my department, Internal Tools, which is essentially a data engineering department. So we extract data from various sources, we prepare, clean it, and store it into a data warehouse. From the other side, there is an analytical department that uses data we prepared from reports, machine learning tasks, etc. And this talk will mostly focus on the data engineering stuff. Now, to our analytical solution, right? The general vibe of our solution can be described as ingest everything, every piece of data, as fast as possible, and with any computational power available. This comes from the following set of initial requirements. From the start, we were required to have solutions that are capable of storing semi-structured data, because we, as you may have noticed, have a lot of games, and each game has its own unique analytical events with unique content per user. So the solution should accept that data at real time. It should be scalable to support increased demand, if any. It should store that semi-structured data of users efficiently and allow to efficiently query it via SQL. And now Citus comes to play. But you may wonder why exactly Citus and not Timescale DB or ClickHouse or YugaByte DB, Cockroach DB, or any other available technology on the market. Well, allow me to answer you with a list of pros and cons, but it will be a little bit dated because we were making our choice 6 years ago. So now, Citus is an open source technology, especially now. It supports JSONB natively because it is an extension of Postgres. These JSONBs are conveniently queried via SQL, familiar to our users. And the Citus itself is an OLAP-centric extension. So it was built with the OLAP use case in mind. From the other hand, there were no columnar storage back then, typical for OLAP. And there were no convenient way to scale the cluster in open source edition. It was behind the paywall. Luckily, today is now day, and both of those issues are resolved. They are in open source, and thanks Microsoft, and especially Citus team. Now, let's see the hardware that we have for that. We use an on-premise installation due to some historical reasons. Here you can see our coordinator machine specs, and here are worker machine specs that we have 40 of. Now, we rely hugely on huge pages, 1 gigabyte in size. We disabled swap. And Postgres configs just reflect the hardware that we have. We also picked Btrfs as our file system. It's a great file system. Being copy on write, it provides us with the ability to make file system level snapshots, which are a perfect solution for quick backups. But more importantly, it is capable of compressing data that it manages. So using Btrfs, we gain a compression ratio about 6:1 using the CompSize tool. And that's essentially how we solved the data issue with JSON, because as you may know, unstructured data is very space demanding. It is great. It's 6:1 is a great ratio for us, but it could have been better if we played with the 6-size compilation flag from the beginning. But yeah, the time has passed. So now let's see the described solution itself. Here's our example of our data that we accept in our system. The first three fields are essentially primary key of an event. And data field can contain any JSON that is required for customer. In order to store that in Postgres, we dynamically create tables that correspond to the event name, and other fields go as is, essentially. But there is also a special profile events designed to store common data for events, so it's like normalization. There is a permanent profile, which is actually updatable entity. So it is designed to store data like register date or country, something that doesn't change over time for all events. And there is a volatile profile for things like user level or something. It is similar to events. It is not updated. It is stored. But upon insertion, we calculate a range of activity for the profile. So the profile considered active from the update time where the profile came to our system and up to the next profile for that users. Combining all this together, we get the base for most of our analytical queries. So this join represents like 95% of queries that are performed in our system. And since this is per user analytics, all of our tables presented here are distributed by the user ID column. Now, I also should mention that we have more tables to support integration with partners like AppsFlyer, Google, etc. But it is a big part of our analytics, but it is not a part of this topic. Maybe next time, this talk, sorry. Maybe yeah, next time, next session. So let's see some actual results of this. Here you see the statistics that we gathered from PostgreSQL statements extension in about 2 months. And as you can see, the vast majority of our analytical queries runs under 30 seconds. Here is a quick plot to demonstrate it visually. And now let's discuss how we gained it using JSONB as our main type of data. So there are two caveats that you should be aware of when you're using JSONB. First, the JSONBs get toasted because they are not restricted in size. And essentially, if they get toasted, it will hurt the performance. But secondly, and most importantly, Postgres still does not gather planner statistics for JSONB content. Essentially, what it leads to, if you have some query that uses JSONB in where clause, your rows get very underestimated, extremely underestimated, and you'll get suboptimal plan. So what can we do about that? Well, to battle toast, we advise our clients to use thinner events and bigger profiles, so the vast majority of events won't get toasted, and profiles will be kept in shared buffers. It can go even further via restrictions, via check constraints or something on the middleware side, but we do not recommend it. It's too restrictive. And you can play around with table settings or even compilation setting for Postgres. But once again, we did not try it. We didn't even need it so far. Now, statistics. First, what you can do with statistics is just accept it. Accept the fact that some of your plans will be suboptimal and maybe add more computational power to it. But if you need to see correct row estimation, so you can spend some space on disk and create a gene index. This is a special type of index specifically designed for composite values, and most importantly for JSONs, is that it supports JSON path expressions. Here is an example of gene index and JSON path expression, and as you can see, row estimations got much better. It's a great solution. It covers all fields, all the field, all columns within it. But unfortunately, it is much slower than B3 index because it uses bitmap index scans. And JSON path itself, while being pretty powerful in capabilities, it is not very readable and reminds me of regular expressions. And it can get very ugly and very fast. So now let's talk about those B-tree indexes. Well, that's quite simple. You can create them on this arrow operator, and with the B-tree index present, the performance is the best. The row estimations is most accurate, etc. But you'll have to create it on each column of JSON separately. Now, there is also an ultimate answer for all our performance issues, statistics, toast, etc. Just add raw computational power. I mean, optimal plan or suboptimal, if you have enough computational power, your queries will perform adequately. And of course, it's mostly a joke. It won't solve all your problems. But again, with Citus, it's a very great option to have sometimes. Now we also have some default indexes that we create for all games to support our base join, right? But we also sometimes need to resort to denormalization because our data can get very big. For example, our biggest table is 28 terabytes in size, and indexes are on our indexes. This join with profiles will not perform well. So what we do instead is just store that value in the event table itself. In order to do that, we just create a corresponding column, write a simple update query that fills that column using the select you saw on the previous slide. This update is wrapped up into callable procedure, and the call of this procedure is scheduled when it is appropriate for us. Using this approach, we eliminate the need of this slow join, and it gets great results. But from the other hand, now we have some historical data with this column field and fresh data where it is not filled. No problem. If you know the threshold of filling, you can just union fresh data and historical data. It is similar to MatViews. This approach is similar to MatViews, might be. And let's see how Citus handles this. Here is a typical analytical query. And when we want to store it on disk, we just create MatView and schedule its refresh, right? All simple, all okay. Now with Citus, you just create MatView, invoke create distributed table on that MatView, and schedule its refresh. Now it's joinable with all other distributed data in our cluster, right? Nope. Unfortunately, there is no way to create a distributed MatView in Citus, and it is by design because developers suggest us to use insert into select functionality. instead. No problem. In order to do that, just create table, regular table distributed, and write a truncate insert procedure that mimics essentially materialized view functionality. Now, all right, that's the gist of our solution. Now let's see how we perform maintenance of all that beautiful beast. So our maintenance is essentially split between the developers who write ingesting middleware, because some tables just a part of, essentially a part of that middleware. But it is wrapped into DBA maintenance that creates infrastructure, databases, etc., roles for that middleware. But from the other side, it creates views and indexes on tables that are managed by middleware. But either way, both parts are managed by a flyweight database migration tool, which allows to store changes to database in a sequence of version migration scripts. Now our DBAs follow the GitOps approach. It means that we have a single repository with automated delivery configured, and every change to the database is performed as a commit to the repository with a migration script. Very convenient, auditing log, etc. Now let's see how we handle multi-tenancy, because we have a lot of games, each game is essentially a tenant. So there are preferred ways to do multi-tenancy in Citus. There is a way where you have a tenant column in all tables, all distributed tables. It is the way described in the documentation. You can also have a schema per tenant in your database. We went another way and created a database-based multi-tenancy. So we create a database per tenant, because we like that strong isolation between tenant. We like that we can have a custom configuration of database per tenant, especially Citus configuration. So we can have different workers for different databases. It was not so easy back 5 or 6 years ago. Surprisingly to us, it is much easier to maintain multiple tenants this way, because we can invoke, for example, parallel migrations for some common object or similar objects between tenants. From the other hand, there are, as you may know, there are no cross-database queries in Postgres itself. I'm more than sure that every Postgres user have seen this error. And we work around it using debugging extension, usual story here. But more importantly, such approach is poorly supported by Citus itself, because one database with Citus requires a daemon process on both machines. It requires n connections, where n is number of workers in cluster for deadlock detection, and two connections for transaction recovery purposes. Now, let's assume that we have a cluster with 40 machines and 30 databases on these machines' workers. Doing a little math, we get 1,260 connections only for maintenance purposes per worker. 60 of them are required each minute by default, and 1,200 I just stay idle all the time. What did we do to battle that is disabled automatic recovery and deadlock detection, and scheduled sequential invocation on all databases ourselves. Luckily, Citus provides us with the functions to invoke both of that manually. But it will not solve all your problems. There are still issues with that. Another point of pain in our maintenance process is multi-level matviews. So consider a scenario where you have matview that depends on another matviews. And you will have to, obviously, to schedule the refreshes in a strict succession. What's wrong with that? You will have to pick time of refresh carefully and manually, and you are at risk to get stale data if there are delays of refreshes somewhere in the chain. the chain. So what did we do to counter that? We implemented a simple event-based solution, neatly integrated with our ETL middleware to essentially configure triggers. And now our views are refreshed on triggers, not the base triggers, but conceptually triggers, when their dependents are ready. What we got is got rid of all cron expressions. Now all the objects are updated automatically, and we do not get stale data. Refreshes may be delayed, but data will always be fresh in those chain. And as nice side effect, we get data to create a fancy actualization dashboard to see the state of refreshes for our views. Now let's talk rebalancing here. Very important part for a distributed database, of course. I once again remind you that it got much easier in recent years. Hooray, and thank you, Microsoft and Citus. But there are some minor issues with that. Minor. First one is, well, issues. Not all edge cases covered with that process. There may be some issues that you will have to deal with it. But more importantly, default rebalancing leads to underutilization of a cluster. How so? Let's consider the situation when we have two workers with four CPUs and four shards per worker. Now we add two new machines to that cluster and invoke a rebalance. After that, we will get two shards per machine. As you may see, two is less than four. So two shards clearly lead to the underutilization of our newly rebalanced cluster. Instead of rebalancing, you can do alter distributed table and change the shard count of the table in question. That way, it will work as expected. You'll get a nice layout of shards according to the number of CPUs, but there are some considerable drawbacks with this approach. First, there is no convenient start function like with default rebalancing that was open sourced. You will have to alter each table that you want to alter manually by name. And what's more important, when table shard count is altered, it is recreated. So you will get a new table with new OID after alteration. And as you may suggest, it means that you will have to recreate all dependent view, all dependent object views, indexes, etc. Citus tries to do that, but unfortunately, there are issues with that as well. Now, at time, if you want to know more about our issues we've faced and how we our practices and conventions, there's a series of posts on the zone where I am after, where I describe that in much more detail. Now let's talk user experience that we users have with our system. Let's talk expectations. We expected our users to have frequent queries with reasonably small results. So all the substantial aggregation will be performed at DB level. Unfortunately, in reality, our users perform one query per day, very slow query, which loads like gigabytes data of size. Why so? Well, essentially because BI tools encourage this. So, for example, common table Tableau BI tool encourages users of extracts. Data science users are used to pandas library or NumPy with their statistical API. So, as a general rule, it is common practice for data science users to perform their data science tasks on a CSV file or something like that. So what we get as a result is user don't care about slow queries and why they, if they run it once a day, and they write inefficient SQL that harms them and harms other users of the system. What we can do with that is educate our users, tell them how to write efficient SQL, especially in Citus, impose some restrictions. There are statement timeouts, obviously, and there is also neat extension to Postgres to prevent users to override these statement timeouts. But you can also get go even further and implement some sophisticated procedure to kill such problematic queries. For those who try to work around those workarounds. And you should obviously monitor how users use your analytical warehouse. Let's see, it's another topic. Let's see how we do that. From our experience, there are two primary metrics to monitor. First one is the memory consumption of queries. Here you can see the our Grafana dashboard of memory consumption per PID and per query within that PID. And we collected using just PGStat activity and PS tool. Nothing unusual here. It is a little bit outdated because it does not use global PID yet, but we are working on it. And query execution times, you already seen that nice graphic. It is based on PGStat statement extension, but we also collect slow queries directly from server logs via copy statement. Sometimes it is a killer feature. Now, what optimization do we have for users to suggest? For Citus users should look out for distributed subplans in their queries. It happens when you try to join distributed tables without usage of distribution columns using CTE, for example. It will lead to distributed subplan in the query plan. And essentially what it means is that Citus will have to pull all the rows from CTE to coordinator and then redistribute them back to workers. By default, this is called intermediate result, and by default, it is 1 gigabyte in size, but as you can guess, it still harms the performance tremendously. So if you see this in your query plans, you will need to either rewrite the query or redistribute your data. Now, I haven't mentioned that, but our data is partitioned, and it is also source of errors because we found out that if you apply some transformation to partition column, the Postgres will not use partition pruning and your query performance will suffer. So just leave the partition column alone. And indexes, well, default advice, if you have some slow queries, just create indexes if they can be useful. So, okay. Now to conclusion. Here are the top wanted features to make our solution near ideal. Obviously, it will be just on based statistics. Obviously, I would like to have multi-level schemas instead of databases. So cross-database reference will be resolved essentially. From Citus, I would like to have sub-partitions because currently it is not possible to create a partition of partition, unfortunately. And distributed mod views. I assume I already described in colors why I would like to have that. And as final thoughts, Citus is a great partition, a great extension for Postgres. It delivers exactly what is promised in docs and learning site, but it is extension. So you should be prepared that there are some edge cases uncovered, there are some integration issues, etc. So every common issue for extension, not a core product. So you can find this presentation here on Speaker Deck. And I am ready for your questions here and on Discord after the talk.
Howdy. That was pretty interesting. A flashback to so many times I've written things like monitoring and custom implementations like that. It's really good.
I was really excited when you said, when you accepted the talk, when you submitted the proposal, when you said you were able to give a live stream version of the talk, not just an on-demand talk, because it's always fun for me to hear how, you know, people are using Citus in the real world, in the wild.
Oh, yeah, it was my pleasure because I wanted to let it out from my chest for so many years. And this is just the tip of the iceberg, actually, because there is so much more.
Yeah, I was going to say, so I noticed on your slide, so you said 2017, like, that, I mean, that's the before times of so many things. What was the first version that you deployed this on with Citus?
I assume 7.0.
7.0, okay, so that's way back.
Citus 7.0.
Citus 7.0. So that's way back. You must have been ecstatic when Microsoft, like, fully open sourced Citus, you know, after the purchase and all that.
You have no idea how tremendous that was for us. It was like our local celebration.
Yeah, and I imagine, because I've run local Citus before for folks, and the shard rebalancer to me was also like one of the key pieces that, like, once that was put out there, like, it was kind of a game changer for people who wanted to do Citus.
Well, once again, as I said in the presentation, it's not a silver bullet. It has its own issues. Yep. But yeah, still, it is so much easier now.
So for people who are just joining, I just want to clarify, Citus, the extension, did go open source back in 2016 when it was first unforked, right, and became a Postgres extension. But there were a few enterprise features that were not open source at that point. So the going fully open source, that was, 2021?
Is that right? Yeah. I remember that day.
There you go. Put it on the calendar. All right. Well, thank you so much. I think there are some more questions in the Discord, as those things tend to do. But yeah, once again, thanks for speaking. And it was fantastic.
Thank you for hosting me here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ivan. Ciao, ciao. Yeah. We'll see you on the Discord.
Bye. Yeah, obviously. Yep. Bye.